Yeah, okay. Actually, I realized in my title I should have replaced actually accuracy by precision, so sorry for that. Yeah, so I will talk anyway about some high precision calculations that we did to determine the atomization energies for a set of test molecules. And actually, I will first. Still there's a problem. No, I cannot read that. Fit page, or the, is it?
F11.
So can you tell me the effect? This one?
Yeah.
Ah, yeah, thanks a lot. Okay, good. Yeah, okay, so I will first introduce actually the kind of the technology that was used for to do those calculations and then kind of draw some conclusions based on those results. So we are using here a non-standard method. It's a multi-resolution method, which is based on wavelets. So I will just tell you a few very fundamental things about wavelets without going into details. And so wavelets are a family of basis functions that have kind of amazing properties. First of all, they are localized both in real and Fourier space, which is quite useful in the context of electronic structure calculation. So in a certain sense, they combine the advantages of Gaussian basis sets, which are localized in real space, and plane waves that are localized in Fourier space. Then there are systematic basis set, like in plane waves, there's essentially one parameter, like in plane waves, right? If you increase your energy cutoff, you are guaranteed to converge with arbitrary error bars to your exact solution. And so the same thing is true here. So that's, of course, in contrast to all the other methods that are can be used to do all electron calculations, where you have always different choices, like you can increase some kind of Lmax to increase your radial resolution, or you can do something to increase your radial resolution. So here, there's just one parameter. Yeah, and then what is very important if you want to do all electro calculations is that you can have adaptivity. So here you kind of can recognize some kind of real small organic molecule with some kind of benzene ring, perhaps, right? And so here this figure kind of gives you an indication of kind of the resolution that can be obtained in such a wavelet basis. And you see as you come closer and closer to the nucleus, right, I mean, you can increase the resolution to any arbitrary high level that you need. Yeah, so we used for the calculations then a code which is called MRChem. So it's using a special type of wavelets which are called multi-wavelets. So this code was actually developed by Luca Frediani in Norway and especially by his student Stig Jensen. And it's based actually on a mathematical theory coming from Gregory Belkin and Walter Harrison. So it performs non-relativistic all-electron density function calculations, LDA, GGA, hybrid functionals can be done at present. At the time when we did this work, the code worked only for free boundary conditions. Actually, very soon it will become available also for periodic boundary conditions. Yeah, and then, I mean, the really nice thing is, I mean, the only input you need is really you give your target precision, and then the code will really automatically, kind of like here, if you go back to this figure, I mean, the code will determine automatically where you need a certain high resolution level to get your answer to this predefined accuracy. So actually, in those calculations, we asked then finally for our accuracy, sorry, precision, of a micro Hartree. So this means kind of 1,000 times better than kind of this typical chemical accuracy that you want to obtain in practice. So yeah, we did those calculations for a test set that contained essentially all of the molecules from the Gaussian test set. But in this Gaussian test set, many elements are underrepresented, and we still have added then some 58 molecules that contain mainly those underrepresented elements. We have only also added a few non-covalently bonded systems. The geometries came from the NIST database, or when they were not available, we did MP2 calculations with the very largest possible Gaussian set. And we calculated the atomization energies actually for both PBE and the PBE zero functional. So on this slide now you see the results. Actually, I think we can concentrate on PBE because the trends for PBE zero are exactly identical. So you see here a first panel with just the total energies themselves, which is perhaps not so relevant. So more relevant is this table here in the middle where you have energy differences, right? We have an atomization energies. And then finally here there's still a quantity which is not variational, right, which is a dipole moment of the molecule. So here you see, I mean, that was kind of our first test. Now we wanted to kind of determine how good are kind of atom-centered basis sets. And so we tested it both for the standard Gaussian basis sets and also then for the basis set from the FHI Ames code, which here, right, is called light, tight, tier 2, tier 4, and so on. Yeah, so what do we see? I mean, if we look perhaps here first at just the average errors in the atomization energy, we see that if you look at the Gaussian basis set, if we use basis sets that are very widely used, we have errors that are quite large, that are close to 10 kilocalories per mole. Remember our kind of magic accuracy that we would like to achieve, this chemical accuracy that's kind of 1 kilocalorie per mole. Yeah, then if you go to larger basis sets, of course, it gets better. But if you really want to be on average clearly below this 1 kilocalorie per mole, I mean, you have to use the largest possible Gaussian basis set, which is actually very rarely used in practice. And even for this case, actually, you can have outliers that are still above your target precision. Another important point is, I mean, if you go to those very large basis sets, you're already in a regime where kind of numerical instabilities arise coming from the overcompleteness of this basis set. And actually, this problem kind of disappears if you go then to the FHA Ames basis set. I mean, there you see, of course, also that you can have a kind of a exploratory basis set where you don't have the required precision, but then here if you go to this higher tier basis sets, I mean you see immediately below this 1 kilocalorie per mole, and actually also the outliers are more or less acceptable. So here in this case, I mean you can reach kind of the typical target precision that you want kind of without running into numerical instabilities arising from the overcompleteness. Yeah, for the picture is similar here for the dipole moments. I mean, perhaps even worse, right? Perhaps a precision of 10 to the minus 2 would be nice. And you see that actually with many of the standard Gaussian bases, that actually with most of them, you cannot obtain this precision. Okay, let me next come now to kind of the second application of those results, which is now concerning pseudopotentials. So here we have now just a subset of molecules. And again, here you see the error in the atomization energy. And you see actually also that those errors can be fairly large. I mean, in this test set, there are some kind of old Truje-Martins pseudopotentials. Perhaps there it's not so surprising that they are not very accurate. But also some of the newer potentials that actually did very well in the delta test, they are not performing well actually concerning atomization energies. I think that's something we have already seen, that unfortunately kind of a good performance in the delta test is not necessarily an indication of a good performance in other contexts. So actually concerning the atomization energies, I mean by far here the best pseudopotential was kind of our own pseudopotential, those HGH pseudopotentials, and actually kind of the modification which is described here in this paper, where we have added a few features that I just want to point out briefly because I think they are kind of responsible for obtaining good atomization energies. So, well, first of all, I mean, here the first features, they are already a part of those pseudopotentials for a long time. So we express the whole pseudopotential in a very simple analytic form that involves only Gaussians or functions that are related to Gaussians, and then there are some kind of, is a relatively small number of variational parameters that we then optimize by a fitting procedure to get our pseudopotential. So it's not based on some kind of inversion of the Schrödinger equation or something similar, it's just based on a fitting procedure. So what we fit is, of course, we fit the eigenvalues, we fit the charges in a sphere, which means just we have the norm conserving condition. But then also we fit actually not only to the occupied states, but also to the unoccupied states, right? And then of course, to get the unoccupied states bound, we need some kind of confining potential. Because we are doing this fitting, actually a kind of zeros of the nodes of the wave function are not causing a problem, and we can include any arbitrary number of semi-core states. What then also follows is that because everything is based on a fitting procedure, actually by construction there are no ghost states. So those are the features that are already present for a long time in those pseudo-potentials. So what we have added now in this paper by Willand is that we fit now to several atomic reference configurations, not only one. And I think that's an important feature. I mean, if you would like, for instance, have a pseudo-potential for silicon, then probably if you have bulk silicon, then probably, of course, you have essentially a neutral atom, and you need very good scattering properties for this kind of neutral atom. But now if you would consider a compound where you have oxygen in addition to silicon, right, then we know that, the oxygen is kind of pulling away electronic charge from the silicon, and then probably your reference configuration should rather be a positively charged silicon atom, right, instead of the neutral silicon atom. So we include something like 20 to 30 different configurations that contain then all kind of ionized and excited atomic configurations, and then we fit all the quantities that I have pointed out here before. Well, we have then also here in this paper introduced the nonlinear core corrections, which help certainly for spin polarized systems. And very recently also we have included terms to improve the softness, kind of to get the best compromise between softness and accuracy. So let me go back to a few results from this paper, where actually now the reference energies, they were not calculated with this micro-Hartree accuracy. They were calculated probably with an accuracy of, a fraction of a milli-Hartree. And there's a Gaussian test set. And you see the results, I mean, with the pseudo-potential that I've just described, and then kind of with this hardest PAW set available in WASP, and then still with a very, very large Gaussian basis set. So you see in those cases, I mean, all essentially the atomization energies are more or less within this error bar of plus minus 1 kilocalorie per mole, and so of course those results are very good. But then, for instance, you could hope that PAW always will give these high quality results. But yeah, in WASP, for instance, right, you have the default PAWs that's shown by the green line. And well, the scale, of course, right, is different between this figure here and this figure here. But you see, nevertheless, this green line is certainly in the interval between plus and minus 4 kilocalories per mole. So that's probably a very good compromise, because that's kind of also the accuracy that probably you have from your exchange correlation function, which is, of course, in this case, right, also like usual, the PPE functional. But then, for instance, if you go to a very soft PAW, then also, I mean, you can get arbitrary, very, very large errors. And of course, also if you reduce, as we have already seen, if you reduce the set of your Gaussian basis set, then also you get very large errors. And again, those errors are so large that they will dominate kind of over the errors that come from the exchange correlation functional itself. So of course, it's well known that empirically that always we have to make a compromise between accuracy and hardness. Nevertheless, at the end, I still would like to show this figure here from a kind of fairly old paper of mine, which I think kind of illustrates kind of the problem we are having with in the construction of pseudo-potentials. So what you see here is actually the difference in the total charge of positively and negatively charged atoms compared to the neutral atom. So you would expect first in a first approximation that this difference in the charge density is essentially the charge density of the orbital that you take out. But actually that's not true at all. You have something like a redistribution of the charge in such a way that always here in this kind of core region, the charge density essentially doesn't change under different chemical environments. So what does this mean? I mean, if you construct a pseudo-potential built on this concept of obtaining good scattering properties, then of course you assume that within your sphere, the scattering, well, let's say on the surface of the sphere, the scattering properties should be independent of the chemical environment. And that's of course only true if the charge density kind of inside your sphere doesn't change drastically, right? So let's say for silicon, I mean, you could choose your cutoff radius for the pseudo potential somewhere here. Then the potential inside the sphere doesn't change a lot. And then if you get very good scattering properties, you should expect to have a good pseudo potential. Yeah, if you do that for oxygen, of course, then you see that this region is much smaller. And then you have two choices. You can either make a hard pseudo potential, or you could try then to make it softer. But then if you make it softer, right, then of course, definitely you have to fit your pseudo potential to different atomic reference configurations, because I mean, here in this region here, the charge distribution, therefore the potential, will change considerably as a function of the chemical environment in which you put your atom. Okay, I'm nearly at the end. Just also, I think concerning the smoothness, we have to also kind of to distinguish what I would call apparent smoothness and rigorous smoothness. Like, for instance, those pseudo potentials were constructed kind of for low plane wave energy cutoff calculations. But if you plot the local part, for instance, you find this behavior here. So you see that you have a very, very strong variation close to the origin, which actually would mean that if you really converge things in a mathematical sense, then you would need here a kind of a huge plane wave cutoff. Even so, I mean, it's intended to be used for with a low plane wave cutoff. Yeah, so I'm at the end. I think it's very useful for kind of benchmarking efforts of the community that now we have also those very highly accurate PBE and PBE zero atomization reference energies. Yeah, I think we have to accept, right, that there are still lots of other approximations that we have to do in all standard electronic structure codes that can lead to significant loss of precision. And yeah, my conclusion is that yeah, we have to intensify our efforts, our validation efforts, in order to get really high credible results from our electronic structure community. So thank you for your attention. Thank you.